Welcome to Work in Progress, the Matrix podcast. In this new episode, host Roger Clements is joined by HSM Advisory's Dr. Sarosh Khan, Cécile Bonnet of Bright Network Academy, and strategic resourcing specialist Deb Aspinall as they navigate the many threads of conversation around the future of work. Packed full of actionable insights and unique perspectives, this is an episode you won't want to miss. Welcome to Work in Progress, the Matrix podcast.
Cécile, Deb, Sarosh, welcome to Work in Progress. Delighted to have you join me today, where we'll be diving into the topic of the future of work, discussing the demographic and societal shifts. I know, Sarosh, you've done a huge amount of research with HSM Advisory on this topic, so I can't wait to dive into that. But I think what I also want to do is take a look at some of the practical implications of that and what we're seeing in the world of work today, and really sort of, I guess, between us all, take an honest view around, is this academic research or is this grounded in reality? And actually, where does that bridge? So to get us started, Sarosh, I always enjoy reading HSM Advisory research, and we were fortunate enough to have you join us at one of our strategic client boards recently, which went down really, really well because it got people thinking. It got people thinking about the way the world of work is moving, but also how that relates to society. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what's really interesting about your research, is this link between the two: societal change, demographical change, but also automation and technology and the implications on the workplace. So, Sarosh, I wonder whether you could give us a bit of a background and a bit of overview around that research, and perhaps that can start framing the conversation today.
So at HSM Advisory, we've been studying the future of work for the last 15 years or so. And we have worked with a whole host of organizations, from FMCG through to financial services through to legal and other. And what we try and do is help organizations think about how they can enable better working lives. And that can take many, many different forms. So it can relate to big strategic questions like the future of work and what does that look like. It can relate to more specific and granular topics, things like culture and values, purpose. And for me, right now, the whole topic of work and people is super, super fascinating. I think it's a great time to be, to be involved in the space. And the way that I tend to describe the future of work is by looking at it from sort of four lenses or four questions. The first is kind of, what is work? And I think one of the interesting things there is that a sort of older view of work was a bit of a means to an end. You did a job, you got paid. And maybe for many people, that's still what they see kind of work as being. But I think for a lot of people, increasingly people who are new to the world of work in particular, they're looking for work and a sort of individual purpose to almost collide and come together. And I think there's a really interesting piece there around, how do organizations give people work that gives them that sense of purpose? So that's the first question. The second question is around sort of when and where people work, which tends to be around, you know, working from home and all that kind of stuff. And that for me tends to be the least interesting one, to be quite frank, but it's the one that I think is still very pressing for a lot of people. Then you've got a question around how work gets done. And I think the rise of generative AI is having a really, really interesting, or shedding a really interesting light on the sort of intersection between humans and technology, and how do we work together with generative AI and other bits of technology. And then the fourth and final one that I think leads interestingly to some that we mentioned sort of before we got started today is, who does work? And within that, what you see are sort of two elements of that. So one is the workforce, and the workforce is changing. We see that across different lenses like age, gender. We see an interesting move from sort of historically being very FTE heavy towards more and more of a focus on contingent workers and freelancers. And I know that we'll talk about that in a bit. But there's also an element of the leadership and managers. And again, we spoke about this just a second ago. But I think the role of managers in particular is just so, so interesting right now. I think the asks, the pressures, the demands on managers, historically you become a manager because you're technically good at something, but you largely have to get on with it. Whereas now you've got to do that, but you've also got to take that pastoral element over people's sort of emotions and how they feel. So for me, just to kind of, I guess, sum up, a really, really interesting time to be in the space. It's very, very complicated, I think. Yeah. There's a lot of different things to be thinking about. But I think there's a huge opportunity to fundamentally rethink about how we think about work.
One of the things you mentioned in your research and in the in the presentation you provided us with the quarterly steering board that time, was this concept of separating age from stage.
Yeah.
Because I think it's been really interesting, if you look at the traditional career hierarchy or traditional career flow, it hasn't really fundamentally changed for generations. Mm. Whereas I think this generation, for me, is that starting point.
Yeah.
Just for those that may not have read the research, but could you just give a bit of an overview around age from stage in terms of what we mean by that? Because I think it will help set some of the context.
Yeah, absolutely. So what we've historically had is this idea of a sort of three-stage life model, whereby you study up until maybe your early to mid-20s, you then work until maybe your early to late 60s, and then you retire. Mm. And increasingly, what's happening is that established model is starting to shift for various reasons. So one of the reasons is the fact that we're simply living longer, right?
Yes.
More and more of us are comfortably living into our 90s and even our hundreds because of advances in health and medicine and all other kind of various bits and pieces. And then the idea of being in retirement for 30, almost 40 years is becoming pretty difficult to really kind of stomach. And so what we're starting to see is much more of a sort of multi-stage life model, one which is much more fluid than what we've had traditionally. So what you see increasingly are more and more people thinking about, well, how do I get into the world of work earlier rather than perhaps my early or my mid-20s? More people thinking, well, actually, maybe I don't want to just work from 25 to 65. Maybe I want to try different things. Mm. You see people taking sabbaticals. You see people stepping out of the world of work after 3 or 4 years and saying, right, I'm going to go try my own thing for a couple of years, start my own business, and then maybe come back into the world of work later. You also see people taking early retirement and then coming back into the world of work down the line. There's a couple of things that I think for me are really interesting. One is, a lot of the organizations I work with are starting to realize that in the not too distant future, they're going to have a very large proportion of their workforce that's over sort of 60, 65. And actually, what do we do in terms of that workforce? What's the value proposition? How do we utilize all of the knowledge, all of the skills, all the talent that they have? And there's also an element of, well, what do we do at the other end of that spectrum? So how do we capture those people who are incredibly talented, who have a lot to offer, but maybe they don't want to go to university or they don't want to go down the traditional route? Or maybe actually they just want to come to us for like 2 to 3 years. And we've got to embrace that, and we've got to try and kind of work with them and get as much out of them, but also give them the skills and capabilities that they want. So for me, I think you're right. It's probably starting to bear out and starting to kind of change in quite a pronounced way. I think there's still quite a long way to go. Mm. But again, I think it's a really exciting opportunity for everybody who's involved within the sort of ecosystem to think about things differently, which I think is nice.
Yeah, it feels to me like it will take several generations, but the concept of retirement, the concept of this later generation of working, it feels to me like that is just become more and more of a myth as more and more we go through, which is just the data says it all, really, doesn't it? In terms of the amount you need to retire on.
Yeah.
If you reach your 50s and you're pretty much through halfway through your working life at that point, the practical reality of pension and your ability to be able to save for retirement. I think retirement was originally did it originate in Germany? I think the actual concept of a pension, and it was, but that's when life expectancy was probably maxed out at 70.
Yeah.
It's just unrealistic now.
Absolutely.
But I think our working world is still gearing towards the old model of retire at 65, 70, which to most is unpractical.
Yeah.
Cécile, I wonder whether I could just bring you into some of the conversation around your perspectives around the younger generation, for sure. I know Bright Network and have a huge amount of respect, and you've probably got the most unparalleled and unrivaled sort of network of about 800,000 graduates.
We're close to a million now.
It's close to a million. Yeah, fantastic.
Yeah. A million, yeah.
And
is that across all disciplines? All of the,
yes, absolutely. Yeah, across all the UK as well. Like, we're number one platform for grad students in the UK. And that's been built over 10 years, right?
And you recently published a report around what graduates want. Mm-hmm. And I think it's impossible for us to decouple some of these conversations, because we can talk about the future of work and where we think the world of work is going. But actually, what do those that are coming out of the education system, whether it's higher or further education, and actually entering the world of work, what does that report, what did it uncover?
It's very interesting, because every year Bright Network looks at doing this kind of research with our members, so all these students who are a part of the network, and we interviewed 40,000 members on the platform, and what comes out is very interesting for those employers. Mm. What do graduates want? Because we are looking to really building that workforce of tomorrow.
Yes.
And we have this question that we ask graduate students about what they value the most when they look at an employer. And we do the same. We ask employers as well, what do you value the most, right, of coming out? It couldn't be, the discrepancy is there.
Oh, right.
Yes, graduates think that industry experience is the top, you know, priority, right? And actually, from an employer's perspective, that's actually ranking the least. And for an employer, actually being able to show resilience and passion for the business is a top priority. So that's really evolved. And it's not so much also about, obviously, the core skills are important, but the ability to be adaptable, the potential, and demonstrating that is it, because things are evolving so quickly, especially in tech. Yeah. Yes. That is a change of ways. And what's happening is that we have there's a bit of rigidity in the education system. Like, you go for that degree, you're going to go into this role. And actually, when you think about it, like when they come out of university, sometimes they realize that's really not what I want to do. I actually want to go in that direction. And so what we've realized at Bright Network is that, you know, we need to give options to people, and that the idea of squiggly career is now more top of mind for, and that we need to nurture that as well. So when we Technology Academy, which I'm leading at Bright Network, is really focused on thinking about those non-traditional pathways.
Yes.
And there's a digital skills gap. We all know that. And so how do we kind of like bridge that, but also help, you know, employers really get those people are going to come in, bring diversity, but also bring a different mindset, you know, to their workforce and evolve it for the future.
You mentioned the gap between what graduates think employers want and what employers actually want. Mm. Isn't one of the challenges that they don't receive meaningful feedback? So, as a, you know, your average graduate will apply for multiple jobs, and they'll receive a standardized automated response that tells them that other candidates are a closer match to the requirement. Mm. And so no one's actually telling them, because I hear this a lot as well from graduates who say, well, I just don't have the experience. And it's in many cases, in most cases, as you pointed out, it's irrelevant. Mm-hmm. But they're not receiving that feedback. And it must be really, really, it's a difficult time, I think, to be a job-seeking graduate during a time where job applications are automated and where there's there's a disconnect between the two.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there is that element of, Gen AI is coming on. You mentioned it as well. And it's interesting to see that actually, you know, more than half of those people who answered that report said they use Gen AI actually to apply for jobs and everything. Yeah. And it's helping them, you know, to gain time efficiency, being better at their wording. But on the other end, when you're hiring them, you're looking at like kind of one single profile. Mm. So it's differentiating themselves, how we continue to kind of let them use the technology, but be able to kind of really stand out, right? In that sense. And to your point about the feedback, I'm not sure that they understand even necessarily what resilience mean in that sense. It's very hard. Yeah. It's a concept more than something you can practice. And I think at university they're not necessarily getting the feedback that you said that helps them kind of get further.
I mean, the thing is, resilience, you can measure resilience when somebody's in a job. But when you're assessing somebody on paper, I think a large proportion, should we say, of graduate job seekers are using AI to help them with their cover letters and to answer screening questions. And employers haven't caught up with that either. So the whole job application and screening process for graduates is just a minefield because of AI, and because you're trying to stand out, and you've also got sort of job application fatigue because you're doing multiple job applications. You have to make sure that each one is bespoke and tailored to the job you're applying for. It's a minefield, and it was easier in my day.
it's really interesting, isn't it? Because we had one of our previous episodes on the podcast, and we were talking about this gap between education and career, and actually how the education system is all driving, is about results out results focus. So it's you kind of go through the education system as long as you get these grades, these results, then actually, and it's all about hard coded skills at that point. Whereas the so-called softer skills are actually the things that we're talking about here, which is actually resilience, empathy, emotional intelligence, those sort of things, which aren't necessarily coded into the education system.
They're not. And they're measured at an application. You know, companies will, haven't seemed to, again, I can only speak from the companies that I've worked for. There's not a huge amount of innovation, certainly in my experience, of how those behaviors, those soft skills, are then measured at application stage. So lots of companies still quite reliant on the assessment center format, which I think plays to certain characteristic strengths more than others. So for example, very difficult for introverts to perform well at in an assessment center setting. And that's how things like resilience and teamwork and things tend to be measured. Yeah. I'm sure there are more innovative ways that companies are trying to measure those things. I haven't personally experienced them.
And I think that for me is the feedback across the industry. I know, Deb, you've worked with some of the biggest employers and you've led some really key strategic projects with likes of ITV and Disney. And actually, that sort of observation is played across multiple large employers as well as the small, and as well as those that are deemed to be fairly innovative and agile. The process for whether it's early in career, whether it's experienced hire. The assessment center model, the assessment model as a whole, hasn't really evolved and kept up with the fact that actually, organizations are not necessarily hiring for those hard coded skills because you bring a skill in today and you're going to be outdated actually in the next couple of years, at most. So therefore, hiring for adaptability, learning, agility are the things that we should be assessing. But yet, most organizations are still assessing for hard coded skills, not the agility.
And that's where you have the question of responsibility that comes in. Like, who is responsible for making sure that those changes happen, right? Because maybe there's that idea of passing the buck. Oh, well, the university will do it. Well, the university can go to a certain extent, right, about doing that. So, you know, how are we able to make sure that we are changing the ways that we go about recruiting the next generation, really?
What I think is really interesting about that, and we've spoken about this previously, Roger, is the implications on social mobility, right?
Yes.
So one of the things that I've been very lucky to do recently is to go and talk at sixth forms and go and talk to 16-year-olds, 17-year-olds about the future of work. And it's incredible how insightful they are and how switched on they are. It's borderline terrifying. But B, it's interesting because the opportunities that I've had have been in schools where students get more support and they get more opportunities. So increasingly what you then see is those instances where they've already got access to resources, they're also getting a better sense of how the world of work is changing, how they're going to need some of those soft skills like empathy, like leadership, a different sense of communication, like resilience. Whereas actually those who don't. Yes. And that's a real frustrating perspective.
Are you seeing, because I think the most recent company I was working for, actually the last two companies, they phased out graduate programs and replaced them with apprenticeship style
you definitely see more
and internships. Are you seeing that reflected across industries?
I think so. I think what I've started to see is more and more of the organizations that you necessarily wouldn't expect, or the sectors that you wouldn't expect, to go down the route of an apprenticeship, where the expectation is that you go to a Russell Group University or an American university or a European university, you get a 2-1 or a first, and that's your route in. More and more of those organizations and those sectors are thinking in different ways around how can we get really, really great talent in. Which, again,
more diverse talent.
And more diverse talent, which, again, thinking about some of the students I've spoken to is really interesting, because some of them, the expectation would have been, I will go to a Russell Group or a Red Brick University or an American or a European university. But they're thinking, actually, I don't want the debt. Or I just want to get into the world of work for 3 to 5 years, build some skills, and then maybe go to an MBA. Or I want to do that, but I then want to go away and build my own business. So all of this for me is really interesting.
And you've got more young people as well working for themselves. So we've got a whole generation of content creators. So the need to go to university, I'm not sure how that affects your business model, because whether you hire non-graduates, but certainly I think there are less, again, I don't actually know this for sure, but it would seem that there are less people going to university for the reasons that you just outlined.
Mm. And I still think, you know, there's certain vocations in life, right? So my wife is a trainee doctor. You've got to obviously do medicine. We do a lot of work with professional services, and they're really struggling at the moment in many instances for accountants. Yes. And you need to have, you know, certain qualifications and have certain skills.
Well, it's not very sexy, is it, accountancy?
It's not.
I'm sure it can be.
It can be, I'm sure.
I'm sure it can be, but that's certainly one of the areas that if you have applications for a marketing program versus your finance program, the numbers are very, very different.
Yeah. This whole debate is really interesting because we were involved in a national campaign earlier this year around trying to actually understand those hopes of actually coming down a level in the education process and sort of year 11, year 12 students who are at sort of that A-level choices around which direction I'm going to go. And one of the really stark pieces of data that's coming out from this was that university in its traditional sense was not as high up as it perhaps was in maybe a generation ago. I think we've gone through this generation where, if you think about government policy, it was all driving around minimum numbers going to university, and so that drove a certain behaviour and a certain stigma to non-university further education activities. And I think now it's getting to that place where we're reversing that and starting to see more workplace degrees, those sort of things, I imagine you're quite heavily involved in.
Yeah, that's right. I think there's also that element, especially when I think about tech, the practical element. Universities are, it's very theoretical. So when they come into the workplace, it's almost obsolete by the time that they apply what they've learned. And then, there is that, you mentioned diversity briefly as well. Like, do you know that only 9% of people in tech are from low socioeconomic backgrounds? Mm.
Well, 9% from low socioeconomic
backgrounds. But in the comparison they have is that 23% of people from low socioeconomic background are into law.
So this is really interesting, isn't it? Because actually, my instinct, whether that's from maybe social biases and whatever it may well be, is that actually that I would have expected that to be flipped rather than 9% from a lower socioeconomic
background
technology.
Yeah, it's still seen, like, tech is unfortunately has an image problem because it's still seen as kind of the second least diverse sector to work in. Especially from Black Heritage member, we only have 2% of Black Heritage member who are into tech, even though more than 80% would like to get into tech, but they don't see themselves, you know, in different environments, tech environments. And then still in 2024, we're only hovering at 25% of women being in tech.
In technology. Mm. And do you think this is down to the fact that technology has kind of been almost wrapped in its own bubble? Because my sense, if we think about the future of work and how automation is permeating every single role function in an organization, are we now in an era where technology has just become part of a job rather than it being the function that sits on the side as a support function to an organization? Actually, yes, that there is an argument for the infrastructure element, but actually digital literacy in employment nowadays is for me a given. And how if I work in accountancy, part of my role surely is to work out how automation is going to drive better productivity, better accuracy, all of the process efficiencies, which you can't do without the digital literacy.
So it's embedded in everything that we do, right? Technology, like, I think it's that broader view as well, what technology is, right?
Yes.
You need, especially with Gen AI, you mentioned it, like, we can't have just pure technologists. You need, like, I was at a strategy roundtable this morning, and we had Jez Bassender, who is the generative AI consulting lead at IBM, and he was talking about the team he's built. And out of the 10 people he has, you know, a lot of them are actually more from humanities background because, you know, for this technology, you need to bring diversity of thought and knowledge in to complement the technology aspect. Yeah. And so that's key as well about how we look at the future of work.
Yes.
We can't just be looking at pure technologists. It's going to have to be a lot more diverse because then, you know, you introduce bias, the wrong bias, and all of those aspects.
You touched on location of work briefly earlier. What are you seeing? What are you hearing from graduates?
Very
and what are you seeing from employers about whether, because depending on what your source is, and the answer is probably somewhere in the middle, isn't it? There are some companies that are now mandating kind of, you know, 4 days in the office.
Mm.
Others have complete opposite approach where it's a fully remote workforce. My experience of young people is that they actually really enjoy and benefit being in the office a lot more than their older colleagues. But what are you seeing?
We asked that question to those members because we're very curious, because obviously since COVID especially, we've seen a complete change, right? And actually 94% of them would like to be in office at least 2 days or more because they want to network, which is the biggest skills they want to learn. And they want to learn from other people. So there is that. Obviously, they want a happy medium as well, right? In terms of what...
And many of them... So sorry to interrupt you. But also many of them are living... Their living circumstances don't lend themselves very well to working remotely.
Yes,
if you're in a shared accommodation.
Absolutely.
So they benefit from being more in the office.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it relates to some of the research I know from HSM around belonging.
Yeah.
And I think for me, that's... We have exactly the same grapple with our own organization, and large number of our customers are also grappling with this. We want to create this sort of a hybrid environment. We want to create a workplace and a work culture that allows agility, allows the flexibility, but we also understand our obligations around creating a culture of belonging.
Mm.
It's that sensitivity, that tension is really difficult to balance, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think the word tension is a really good word to use. And increasingly what we find is there are just tensions all over the world of work between the long term and the short term, between the flexibility that people want, the ability to decide for themselves what works for them, but increasingly that ability to be kind of told a little bit around how things ought to work and how they ought to behave a little bit perhaps at times.
Yeah.
I think on the actual topic of what people want, what's really interesting is it tends to be the layer in the middle that are the ones who can be the ones who are the most difficult to kind of work with.
Yeah.
To your point, Cécile, it's the people who are new to the world of work. They want to be in the office. They oftentimes, as you said, they don't necessarily have the space at home to work comfortably. They want to be around other people. They have an expectation of work that I'm going to go in and how, you know, I'm going to learn if I work at a global bank. Well, I'm going to learn more about the bank by being connected with more people, building relationships, understanding, do I want to work in strategy or marketing or HR, whatever it might be, and navigating through. You find people who are the most senior people often want to be in the office because that's what they're most comfortable with. That's the world of work in which they've grown up.
And they're leading.
And they're leading. Yes. And it's that collective in the middle who I have a huge amount of empathy for because, again, I think we're asking so much more of them now than ever before.
Yeah.
Many of whom are quite comfortable working at home. They've got the space. They've got their networks established. They've got, you know, friends and
they've got the dog that they can walk.
They've got the dog. They've got kids that they want to. Mm. You know, I have a couple of kids, and I was sharing before the start that actually, you know, I really value those days that I'm at home and I can do drop off and pick up. And if I had to be in the office 5 days a week, I don't know how I'd feel about that. Mm. But it's that middle layer that can be the most problematic to sort of re-engage and to kind of bring back in.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because I think when you look at, again, looking at age and stage is an interesting, really interesting one, because you bring in your early career, you build your network, you build, and actually some of that is all around in person. You build your connections either in the workplace or within the broader industry, we're social animals, right? We connect on a person to person basis, but to your point on the maybe it's the middle layer.
Yeah.
They've gone there, they've done that, they've actually built that. And now maybe COVID and the pandemic, I think we can still talk about it, it's still recent memory, actually has that accelerated it. It's just accelerated this sort of acceptance of, actually now I proved I can do it. But it's perhaps the early generation, the younger generation that are coming into the workplace that are really craving the identity, craving the belonging, but the middle section is not able to give it to them because they crave something else.
Yeah, they'll have, I think, the situation here is that obviously these people who are more prone to kind of, you know, being home, they hold also a big part in what the culture of the company is.
Mm. Yeah.
And so, you know, again, going back to our research, like, the fact that some people choose a specific company to work for is because of the culture and the people that are there.
Yeah.
And so they may not be able to experience it as much. So you may have an impact on retention and, you know, continuing to attract talent because you don't have those people who are nurturing the culture being there every day and showing it how it's manifesting itself.
I was going to move the conversation now in a related field, but slightly shifting it on to talking about blended workforce composition and the blended workforce, because it's been a really big theme of human capital management, workforce management around, are we moving to this nirvana of the 50-50 workforce and the 50% of the workforce being direct versus indirect? And is that reflective of what perhaps graduates or young generation are seeking from the workplace. But Sarosh, I know that there was a really interesting article that Linda Gretton, who you work really, really closely with at HSM, around, I think the title was genius. It was, I think, highly skilled professionals want your work, but not your job.
Yeah.
And it's a really, really interesting piece of research that I was reading, which really starts looking at the stats are stark. I think they were saying that 55% of those organizations that were researched were saying that in the next 3 years, not in the next decade, but in the next 3 years, there will be much more of an equilibrium between those that are in the freelance and the indirect economy and those that are on payroll. What's your reaction to that? Are you seeing that playing out yourself in terms of the research you're doing?
Yeah, so it sort of varies a little bit from company to company almost. So there's one statistic that really sticks out for me that Linda shared with me when she was doing her work, which was in one organization that she and Diane interviewed.
Yes.
Around 50% of the people in the in this organization that was an F&S organization were contractors / freelancers.
Yeah.
I think it's the bigger piece, right? Where you've got a bank where you would think it's a bank. Everybody here is going to be a full-time employee, probably working, you know, 9 to 5, 9 to 6. We're not going to have the degrees of flexibility that people would expect in other instances. And the fact that you've got huge chunks of this global bank where you've got people who are not FTE, I think that for me was a really, really interesting.
Although there could be an FTE with another company sat on site.
Yeah, possibly.
In financial services, that's more likely to be the case than there to be, huge... freelance pool.
I think a lot of the research was actually excluded some of that statement of work sort of piece. It was because one of the things that I was really taken by was the thinking around culture as it relates to the indirect workforce. Because I never before, the debate around flexible blended workforce and this sort of fusion of direct and indirect workforce coming together. This was the first time, it's really been in the last 6 months, the first time that the idea of culture and belonging has entered the conversation around blended workforce. Partly, as a result of the need, the fact that if you've got a HR function, then actually you can't have a HR function or a workforce function that's only responsible for 50% of your workforce. You've got to start bringing that together.
And that's actually, you know, in terms of that kind of new way of building your workforce, you know, that's how we look at it for the Technology Academy, because we're doing the recruit, train, deploy model.
Yes.
So, but when it comes to culture, for us, it's very important that, you know, those consultants that go at our customers, yes, they are Bright Network employee effectively, but we have them for 2 years at our customers or partners, and they learn about that culture and they grow in that culture. So it's a bit of like, you need to embed, I think, like people who come maybe who have been there FTE and then those non-traditional pathways, because they all bring something to the table.
Yeah.
I think it's enhancing the culture of a business that way because of the experiences and what they are able to add, creating more diverse team, etc. But it's very interesting how it's evolving. And sometimes I'm not sure that the HR part of the business is ready for that change, maybe, of thinking about workforce in a different way.
Oh, I completely agree with you. I think one of the things that I always find really interesting are those HR leaders and those other HR practitioners who are more strategic in their thinking, who see that this world of work that we now find ourselves in presents a massive opportunity mm-hmm. to do something incredibly different versus those who still see their role, I think, as a bit more along the lines of almost firefighting.
Yes.
And I
yes.
think that sometimes yep. can be dictated by the broader organization, but I think there's a massive opportunity for those people who think, right, I really want to do something different, carve a different path.
Mm.
Yeah.
Deb, from your experience in leading some of the strategic resourcing programs you've been front and center of, are you seeing this really manifest in currently in large employers, the consideration around direct and indirect, or are you still seeing there being this firefight to actually just attract talent and we need to go to our default model of direct?
Maybe neither. I think the challenges you have... HR, as you've said, who are responsible for the employee base and the life cycle of your employees. And then very often it's procurement or a completely different team who are responsible for the strategy of hiring freelancers, for the onboarding of freelancers, the payment of freelancers. Mm. And there's not really a joined up sort of OD team, OD strategy that looks at, okay, what's the job that needs to be done and what's the right category of worker to bring in to do that job. So I think that often organisations are just responding to headcount challenges. I mean, not in all companies, but in many they have headcount challenges. And so where they can't get headcount for a certain role, they'll then bring in a non-employee
yes.
to fill that gap. And that then they'll go to the strategic sourcing team, procurement, wherever they're called, to engage with a vendor to bring somebody on site.
I guess it's the augment. So that would be a very traditional way of the contingent workforce, but it's almost staff augmentation, isn't it? It's we have an urgent need. We can't find someone on a permanent basis, and we haven't got anyone internally. So therefore, a contractor is an augmentation to our team rather than it being a part of a well thought through strategy that says actually these roles are going to be our strategies, that these role categories will be the flexible economy potentially.
And it does work a bit more like that in creative industries because there are clearly some, you're working on a project, a piece of content, a film and so on, you're going to have to source that via freelancers.
Yes.
But I certainly for like corporate functions, for tech functions, I think it's a mix.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a highly sort of strategic exercise.
Yeah, you're also trying to address the skills gap, right? Because
yes.
unfortunately, there are so many people who have the talent that you're looking for. So you have to find other ways and strategies to be able to kind of bring in the people that you need in order to be able to achieve your results in the organization.
Yes, no, and actually, I think that the automation agenda and it is actually driving some of this as well, which is we don't have the skills internally to deliver the sort of automation and the sort of digital advancement we need in our organisation. So therefore, those individuals largely get brought from the freelance economy or the contingent economy. And then it's how do you then blend those in with your existing organisation so that you upskill your organisation.
And it doesn't help if you've got two different vendors looking after you. You know, if you've got a managed service provider looking after your temporary workforce,
yes.
you've RPO'd your permanent. And so actually people are not necessarily incentivized to work together to solve the problem of how you get the best talent. So you've got two very different work streams. And you probably would need to have one overarching company that you incentivize to manage more of a total talent management sort of approach.
Yeah. So we are rapidly running close to time, and I've thoroughly enjoyed the conversation today. So thank you, Deb, Cécile, and Sarosh for being part of this podcast today. What I would like to try to do is try to get some practical thoughts going forward. Hopefully through today, we've proven that actually, hopefully this is moving from academic into reality. And certainly the data seems to suggest that. But perhaps if I could ask you, what would be the one piece of practical advice you'd give organisations now around how they could set themselves up to thrive in the in what we're calling now the new work order?
I guess for me, I'm always staggered by the number of organisations I work with that don't really have a strong sense of what their people want and what they look for.
Okay.
I think sometimes I find organisations think they know what their people want, but they've never actually had those conversations. So I always encourage organisations and leaders to talk to people, ideally in person, have conversations like we're having today, get a real sense of what people want, and then try and experiment. What's the worst that happens? You experiment with something, it doesn't work.
Yes.
Fine. Or you experiment with something and it does work and you have some really interesting results around how you can move forward.
Mm.
So I think for me, trying to get a good understanding of what people want, what do they look for in the future, whether that's around the kind of work they do, whether that's around where they work, when they work, the role of technology, whether it's around how they want to work in terms of being a full-time employee or a freelancer in the future, whatever it might be. And then just try and do some experimentation and see where that takes you.
Cécile, how about you?
Yes, I think despite economic headwinds and maybe some market challenging condition, I think companies still need to think about future-proofing their business and continuing the hiring, bringing in kind of like the next generation into the workforce, because these people are going to be the future leaders, and being open to those non-traditional pathways because they can really enhance your teams. And I think another thing that businesses really need to keep thinking about and keep at the center is that whole element of diversity. How can you attract and retain that talent and make sure that, you know, they can thrive in those environments, because you can't be what you can't see. So if we want more women, more people from underrepresented community to join your business, then invest in hiring them and really kind of getting them in your teams.
Great advice. Thank you, Cécile. How about you, Deb?
I think that HR teams generally are just burdened with a lot. And there's a lot of priorities. And I think that leaders would benefit from unburdening some of their teams by enabling them to zoom out, to take more of a strategic view, by perhaps just, you know, having cross-functional project teams where they're actually given the time and resource to focus on what does the future of our talent look like and how do we work across teams to achieve that. I think it's a real challenge to have people do that alongside their day jobs.
Well, look, thank you, Deb, Cécile, Sarosh. Really, really grateful to have you on the podcast today. Thank you so much for your time, and look forward to seeing you again soon.
Want to stay up to date with the latest insights from the world of work? Subscribe now to Work in Progress, the Matrix podcast, available wherever you get your podcasts.